Hello and welcome to the Practice Parlour. I'm Gina Morgano and I'm here today with Sharon Aronofsky Weltman. Excuse me. Welcome to the Practice Parlour, Sharon.
Thank you. I'm delighted to be here.
Sharon is the Director of Comparative Literature at Louisiana State University, the Professor of English, and co-editor of the 19th Century Theater and Film. She is a Victorian scholar and a Broadway buff, and she is the author of the new book, Victorians on Broadway, Literature, Adaptation, and the Modern American Musical. So I invited Sharon here today to talk about the book. If you know me, you know that I am completely obsessed with everything Victorian and everything Broadway, and particularly Victorian set Broadway musicals. So I'm so excited for this conversation, and thank you for agreeing to be on the Practice Parlour. So I'd love to start off by hearing a little bit of your background and your story, how you became interested in literature, in the Victorian time period, in Broadway musicals, and how that all came together for this book.
Well, that question actually has many answers. So who am I? Well, as you said, I'm a professor of English at Louisiana State University, and my field is Victorian studies, but I have also been working a lot on theater history. So when I became the co-editor of 19th Century Theater and Film, you can see that, you know, it's obvious that in the last decade at least, my work has become more and more not just Victorian literature, but Victorian culture more broadly. At first, I was working with Victorian visual culture, and then a little bit with Victorian print culture, and then fully whole hog into Victorian theater, and then Victorian adaptations and appropriations of Victorian theater in contemporary culture. So the whole afterlife of Victorian literature as it is performed, especially. I'm interested when I teach Victorian afterlife of various kinds. It's often in other media, not necessarily in theater, because getting people to live theater is more of a challenge when you're teaching Victorian literature classes. But I've taught many a class called Victorians Performed in a similar title to that. And so it's, you know, sometimes it's focuses more on actual live theatrical performances when I can arrange for the students to see them, but sometimes it's more Victorian literature as appropriated to film or to graphic novels or to other novels that are revising and reimagining Victorian literature, a whole field that's sometimes called neo-Victorian literature. So that has been my sort of progression intellectually. Now, where does that come from? You know, I have plenty of actors and performers in my family. I'm, you know, an amateur performer myself. So, you know, it's the love of the theater and the love of singing and dancing is there. Even up until very recently, I even still performed with Baton Rouge Ballet Theater's at school outreach program called Ballet for Children. I was performing the role of the witch, which is a very forgiving costume. And even at my age, you know, I could still go out there. So the performance element of it is something that is deeply ingrained and goes back really to childhood and a family full of performers.
That's so cool. So why did you decide to write this book and why now?
So the now is really a big question because the book has many origin points. So in some ways it started when I completed my last book, which was called Performing the Victorian, and it was about Victorian writer named John Ruskin and his ideas about theater and performance, and also plays and an opera that where he's a main character along with Oscar Wilde. So that came out in 2007. So in many ways, the book has an origin point there. because that's when I could turn to it full time. But I first started noticing this huge number of wonderful musicals based on Victorian books and poems in the 1980s, when there was just a big sort of rash of them. And it happened to be when I was in graduate school, living in New Brunswick, in, you know, near New Brunswick, because I was going to, I got my PhD at Rutgers. So I got to go to New York all the time and see all these plays. And I became very interested in how Victorian literature is being performed and what uses it was being put to, how England becomes a kind of a substitute place. Victorian England becomes a substitute place for contemporary United States for working out issues that we want to work out. And especially in the ways that sometimes the musicals and other productions are less sort of tackle some of our contemporary issues in ways that are even less progressive than the Victorians did, but then they find other ways to bring the progressive message in. So I became fascinated with how the creators of musicals based on Victorian materials were making the material accessible to a Broadway audience while retaining key features of the story and the ways in which we interpret that literature, but reinterpreting it musically and through the spectacle of dance and staging. And all of that fascinated me because it's not something that literary scholars ever talked about, because Victorian literature is often read in isolation from even within the Victorian period. It's often read in isolation from theatrical culture and musical culture, the Broadway, the idea that a Broadway musical, which is a middlebrow entertainment, could be an exciting way to think about interpreting this literature isn't something that normally literary scholars take into consideration. Because it requires thinking about, as I was just saying, the spectacle, the dance, the music as storytelling elements, which is not something that literary scholars are typically trained to do. Most of the work up until really fairly recently, probably only about 20 years ago, did we start seeing people looking at Broadway musicals from this storytelling, where the people who were studying it weren't mostly musicologists or musical theater historians, but a broader sort of attention began to be paid to it by other kinds of scholars.
So before we get into the content of the book, this is such a scholarly work. I mean, the amount of detail and research that went into it is quite astounding. So this is the practice parlor, and I'm wondering about what some of your practices were for researching and writing.
Yes, yeah. So lots of times when I would be thinking about something like, say, Goblin Market, which was composed by Polly Penn and is such a wonderful musical, and the first one that I wrote about back in 1989 when I was at Rutgers, first regional production was at the MacArthur Theater at Princeton, and I went and I made all my students go. I didn't make them go. I mean, I gave them extra credit if they would go, and they would write up a little response. And I interviewed the director, Victoria Liberatore, and so some part of my practice was going with I mean, it had nothing to do with my dissertation. It had nothing to do with anything I was working on. But I was just fascinated that somebody had made a Broadway musical out of this poem, Goblin Market, which is a great poem, a wonderful narrative poem about two sisters who, you know, one saves the other, and there's all this amazing sexual imagery that, you know, and religious imagery, and sometimes it's the same lines that are both religious and sexual. It's a great poem. And I was so thrilled and excited that someone had made a musical out of it. And so one of the practices is getting other people involved in thinking about the things I'm thinking about, so that then I have someone to talk about it with. And the students, you know, then I didn't do anything with that for years, because, you know, my dissertation was not on that topic. And it wasn't until I wrote an essay for a book collection after I'd finished the dissertation, after the first book was almost done. And then that article was named a finalist by the Kurt Weill Foundation for best article in musical theater. And so that convinced me that maybe I should keep going with that kind of work. So that happened in 1999. And even then, I didn't really get to work on it again until after 2007, when my second book came out. The practice, second, I guess, practice is to remember that nothing is wasted, and that the ideas that I have, you know, I can set something aside and let it percolate for decades, and then still come back to it and still have something exciting, find that something exciting is happening. So what happened, you know, decades later is that I contacted Polly Penn and asked her if she would let me interview her. And she said yes. So the next time I was in the New York area, I took the bus up to her home a little bit upstate. And if you know the poem Goblin Market at all, then you know beautiful fruit is a big part of this poem. And she had laid out for me at the table just this, you know, spread of grapes and cheeses and things. And another writing practice is to, you know, actually talk to the people that I think would be, you know, these incredibly generous people that let me interview them. Other practice, well, writing is a lonely activity. If anyone of your listeners is also a writer, then my main practice that might be of use to them is to get into a writing group. And over the years, I've had a number of writing groups because these things, they have a lifespan. People's lives go off in other directions, and then they can't be in the writing group anymore. But the longest one I had, I think, was 11 years. And that's fantastic, because then you have people who you can bounce ideas off. They have wonderful suggestions on the writing itself. You learn so much from them because you read what they're writing and you spark one another's thoughts. So those are the main practices.
Thank you for that. That's wonderful. So you mentioned in the book that Victorian texts have inherently theatrical, they're right for adaptation. And I'm wondering what makes them so.
That's a great question. And the perfect person to look at is Dickens for that. And in fact, the book has two chapters centered on musicals based on works by Dickens. It has the chapter on Oliver, on the musical Oliver, based on Oliver Twist, of course. And it has a chapter on The Mystery of Edwin Drood, which of course is based on a novel of the same name by Dickens. In talking about Dickens, this is really kind of an easy question to answer, because he wrote to be performed. You know, the adapter is working from material that the author knew would be performed. Everything that he wrote was immediately adapted to the stage. Often, way before he finished writing it, because all his novels were published serially. So if a novel comes out in, you know, say 20 parts, you know, it's being serialized, you know, perhaps for a year and a half, right? So it's so with Oliver Twist, there's this great story that the adaptation that he went to see, like, you know, many months, half before the novel was halfway over, he actually went to see it and was so embarrassed by what they were doing to it that he lay down in his box and refused to get up again until after the curtain call. So so he knew that he would be adapted immediately. And it's actually a great book on this. It's a two-volume book called Dickensian Drama, that's edited by Jackie Bratton and Jim Davis. And that book is a collection of plays, 19th century plays based on Dickens. And the introduction is full of all sorts of great information about that. So since he knew that he was going to be adapted, he sometimes would work with early adapters, giving them advance, you know, proofs and, you know, advanced versions, so that they could, so there could be an adaptation that he had some control over. He got no money from adaptations. There was no copyright protecting authors for plays adapted from their works at this time. And then there's one more story about how it is that Dickens was writing for performance. And that is you were asking about writing practices. His writing practice, according to his daughter, who wrote this about this later, she was asleep one day in the where he was writing, and she'd fallen asleep on the couch. And when she woke up, she saw her father writing out the character's dialogue while looking in the mirror, acting the part and writing as he was acting. So, I mean, he was himself an amateur performer. He almost became an actor. He had an audition at Covent Garden, which, of course, is a big London theater. He actually had an audition as a young man before he became a famous writer. And then he got a cold and he couldn't go to the audition. And then in between then and when he could schedule the next audition, he got his first story published. So everyone wonders, you know, if he hadn't gotten that story published, would it perhaps, you know, we wouldn't have had any of these novels. Instead, we would have had another great luminary on the stage, but not any of his novels. So he's a really good sort of example of, you know, while, you know, since he was so well known and his works were so beloved and followed, absolutely everything he wrote was immediately performed. But really, a lot of these works were immediately performed. He's not the only one that would have to keep that in mind. The illustrators really kept it in mind, because a lot of the illustrations would be what's called realized on stage. And you may be familiar with this in Sunday in the Park with George, right? So where they realize it. So that happened all the time in Victorian theater. And it certainly happened in melodramas, which were a musical form. The illustrators would choose theatrical moments if they looked like they could be dramatized. You know, there's a, you know, if you look at those early illustrations, they're often very melodramatic moments. Well, that's because they were going to be melodramas.
So when we look at these Victorian texts, and they were right away put on stage, and they've been adapted and adapted again and again and again, I'm wondering, in your opinion, what is it that gives them this staying power?
That's also just a really good question. And there are adaptation theorists that think about this. And one of the answers to that is that it's a kind of a cycle, a little bit of a feedback loop. Something that's wonderful or exciting or popular gets adapted. and that increases its popularity and people's knowing about it. And then it gets readapted, and then it gets readapted. So a lot of things that we see on Broadway were previously films. Those films were adapted from earlier films, which might have been adapted from so-called silent films, which were never silent, right? They always had musical underscoring. And those early film adaptations were often directly taken from melodrama adaptations that were directly taken from the novels originally. So this whole genealogy of adaptation confers the staying power in a way. It's the idea that there's a literary canon, right? That canon is in part sort of kept in place by popular adaptations. So they're adapted because they're famous. They're famous because they were adapted.
And what do you think that these, either the original texts or the musical versions, what do they offer us today? Because, I mean, we still are drawn to them. So what do they offer our society and our culture?
Right. So what the musicals offer, of course, let's be real, is amazing entertainment, right? Amazing entertainment. But they also offer interpretations of Victorian texts, and they offer ways in which we can understand Victorian culture and our culture. So these are really important things. The entertainment value, I'm not going to discount that. I mean, who doesn't go to the theater to the musical theater in part to be entertained? But that entertainment comes with, I would argue, serious intellectual work that's happening, even if you don't realize it. So in terms of its, you know, musicals having actual, teaching us things, for example. Another good example would be the musical, let's stick with Oliver, because everyone knows it. When you see the musical Oliver, you are introduced to the character of Fagin. And Fagin's a really important character in that musical. Arguably the most important character in the musical, even though it's called Oliver. The actor who plays Fagin always gets the final curtain call. He has a lot of songs. He's a comedian oftentimes. Sometimes he gets to put in his own shtick. A lot of times Fagin is first introduced, people who go to see the theater meet Fagin for the first time often, or if they see the movie version of it, they meet Fagin for the first time often through those vehicles, not through reading the novel. And then they go and read the novel later. So part of what happens is it introduces people to the Victorian texts themselves. They're curious about them after they've seen the musical. You see that with Hamilton, for example. People are becoming more interested in Revolutionary War history. And no one pretends that it's accurate, right? Or they shouldn't. It raises issues. It helps us look at it in a new way. And that's certainly true for Oliver as well. Well, one of the news ways it makes us look at it is to think about the character of Fagin. Because when you go back to the novel, what you find is that Fagin is a horribly anti-Semitic character. I mean, the portrayal of Fagin is truly anti-Semitic. So what's going on with that? So for people who first read the novel, it's, you know, Fagin is very hard to deal with. But if they've seen the musical first, then they can see in the character of Fagin, even as Dickens has written it, even as anti-Semitic as it is, they can see those elements that Dickens wrote into it that allowed the evolution to the not anti-Semitic character that we see in the musical. And it has a fascinating history. Since I was saying that in all these chapters I do this genealogy of adaptation, it has a fascinating history of how you can get from the really anti-Semitic character to the, you know, lovable scamp that is the Fagin of Oliver. So that's a long story.
Wow. So you mentioned in the book, there's several, I guess, themes we can call them. The idea, the concept of melodrama and Americanization and feminism and the religion, we could go on and on. I'm wondering if you could maybe illuminate a few of those as they appear on the stage and maybe similarities or differences to the novel.
Yes, right. Yes, okay. I guess we can talk about the Americanization for a moment. Because all of these works are British 19th century, you know, Victorian texts. So why are they on the American, why Broadway, I suppose is really the question. And so what work are they doing on Broadway that helps us understand ourselves better as American Broadway theater goers? Because in that sense, it's not about Britain, it's about the United States. And this is true of adaptations generally. Adaptations often tell us as much about the moment and the place where they're adapted as they do about the source text. And the source texts are rich enough that and flexible enough to be readapted and reperformed and re-understood. And when we're doing that, we're understanding ourselves. Let's take Jane Eyre, the musical Jane Eyre. It has a scene that is just fascinates me. And that is the scene, the character Jane sings a song about liberty, about sweet liberty. And right away, if, you know, you grow up in the United States, you this will echo My Country, 'Tis of Thee, right? So when she sings about sweet liberty, she is addressing the students, those of you who are viewers who know Jane Eyre, know that Jane has been teaching at a school, and she longs to leave it and find a new adventure, new employment. She does do that. She even if she realizes that as a woman, she doesn't have a lot of options. So she wants liberty and to have adventures, and then she realizes, no, all I can hope for is a new servitude. So she applies for a governess position, and she goes off and she becomes a governess in the novel. And those of you who know the novel, of course, there's this whole love story with Rochester. But before that really happens, she goes up onto the roof of the manor house where she's living, and she makes this sort of plea that, and many people read as a great feminist plea, that maybe is Charlotte Bronte herself speaking out through Jane Eyre, where she says, you are ungenerous if you don't think that women want as big a scope, a field of action as their brothers, right? So this is all really cool about freedom and independence and liberty and action for women. What happens in the musical, of course, is that it's written at a time, it's written in 2000. It premiered in, was on Broadway in 2000. And so women already have many of the freedoms that Charlotte Bronte and her character Jane Eyre could only dream of. So what happens to this moment that is such a feminist statement in the novel is that she sings about wanting sweet liberty while she's, it becomes not a private thought to herself, but where she's teaching the students at Lowood. And during the course of the song, she packs her bag and she, sort of charges off across the stage to go to Thornfield. And the sense that you get from as an audience member is not that this is a statement about a collective feminist movement, a call for freedom for women to be able to have the same experiences and the same opportunities that men have. Instead, it becomes an individual, and that, and in that sense, very Americanized, a notion of freedom. It's of your individual freedom to leave your individual place where you're individually unhappy and go off to move to the place where you're going to get married. So that I read as an Americanization of what had been a collective claim to something that is, you know, because we're in the United States, we're very, you know, very focused on our individual freedoms. That's one example.
That blew my mind when I read it in your book. And the other thing that you mentioned was the parallel in the original production, because I believe in the they've made a more chamber version, and so they've changed it. But the original Blanche Ingram very much resembled Blanche Dubois.
Yes.
Sweetheart Named Desire.
Yes.
That astounded me once you pointed that out.
Yes, yes.
So I don't know if, you know, that was Paul Gordon and John Caird's intentions or not, but that brings me to this next question. I'm hoping maybe we can just kind of define these terms a little bit, the terms adaptation, appropriation, and interpretation. I think they get thrown around a lot, and I would love to hear you explain it a little bit.
Okay, good. So there's a book by Julie Sanders called Adaptation and Appropriation, and Julie Sanders defines what she means by these terms, and that's very, very useful. So for her, an adaptation is something that is, a straight up mediation of the material from one medium to another, where it often has the same name, a title, or a similar, very similar title, and where it retains as many elements as possible. Now, she contrasts that with what she defines as an appropriation, which takes elements that may move the work very far afield from the source text. It's useful to be able to use those terms in those distinct ways. And my students love to be able to distinguish between what is an adaptation and what is an appropriation. For me, however, the terms blend into one another. So I see appropriation and adaptation as more on a sort of a sliding scale or a spectrum, more enmeshed anyway, because I get distracted by trying to put it in one category or the other, and I find that the freedom of just basically calling everything an adaptation allows me to talk about things that are appropriations that Julie Sanders would define as an appropriation in much closer contiguity with the source text. And adaptation theorists are very, they don't even like the term source text, you know, because some adaptation theorists are very interested in getting us away. The whole movement in adaptation studies in recent years has been to get away from the idea that an adaptation has to be faithful to the source. Instead, we should be thinking about the adaptation as its own art object, to get away from the idea that the sort of classic statement when somebody goes to a movie based on a favorite book, well, they'll come out and say, oh, the book was better. That's not as useful as going in and saying, well, I'm gonna see what this is like. I'm gonna see how this works differently from just whether or not it's faithful to the text. Fidelity isn't everything.
And so then what about interpretation? And also when we're looking at the creators of these musicals and how they chose to interpret, what did you notice? Were there common threads?
Yeah, that's a good question too. So interpretation comes into it because you can't adapt without interpreting. So every choice that an adapter makes is an interpretation. All the things that they cut makes it into an interpretation, because they've decided that those things can be cut. and that the kernel of the story that they want to tell isn't in the things that they're cutting, or they're finding something to substitute for what they're cutting that tells the story visually or musically or in dance. So that's very much an interpretation, just the cuts. And then, of course, there are all the other elements that go into an adaptation. So you see this again with Oliver Twist and Oliver really clearly. When you cut out, in the novel Oliver Twist, there are these huge subplots with another female character besides Nancy, who is a sort of her foil, where everything, you know, Nancy's the prostitute and Rose Maylie is the, you know, the angelic figure. But once you remove Rose, then Nancy is the only important female character. Nancy becomes much more important. And Fagin also becomes much more important because suddenly he's in many ways a nurturer, and he takes over, he becomes the domestic character that's taking care of the boys and Oliver. So take the no matter what you do when you adapt, you're also interpreting. And those interpretations can be, as I said before, in terms of understanding Fagin, really useful in highlighting things that you might not have noticed about the book otherwise. But they're also, so for literary scholars, you know, they can start thinking about musicals in these utilitarian terms of, you know, what you have, or not utilitarian, but you know, the ways in which they're useful. For people whose main interest is in the Broadway musical, thinking back about the source texts, and I have to go ahead and use that term, even if some people don't like it, because it's kind of makes a hierarchy, like it's the source, so it's so much better, but it is the source. So it is one source. That's we should get into that too. There are many sources for these. For one musical, there are actually many sources. What it does for a musical theater aficionado is that you understand so much more of what's going on in the musical story if you're familiar with the novel. So that, for example, when I interviewed Rowan Atkinson, when he portrayed Fagin in the 2009 London revival of Oliver, I asked him if he had read the novel, gone back and reread the novel, is what I said. And yes, so very often people will go to the source to more fully understand the character that they need to portray on stage, because there is a backstory to all of these characters that you're embodying, and that backstory is in the novel or in the literary work that comes from.
So when I think of these Broadway musicals, I think most of them capture a Victorian aesthetic visually.
Yes.
And musically, there are a lot of different styles represented.
Yes.
So you have Frank Wildhorn and Paul Gordon, who come from more of like a rock pop world.
Yes.
Sondheim, it's operetta, opera. Lionel Bart, it's more like boom, papa.
Exactly.
So I'm wondering if you have any thoughts on the musical interpretations, and also if maybe you have any stories from your interviews to share.
Ah, gosh, that's a really good question. Now the composers are not going to be trying to Richard Rogers or Oscar Hammer, I think it was Richard Rogers, called it research poison, where you go back and you try to replicate the sound. So there's very little of that in these musicals. Polly Penn did use a little Brahms, who's an exact contemporary of Christina Rossetti, in Goblin Market. But that's just an interpolated little musical moment that was very effective. But most of the time they're using their own sound. And although, you know, so, okay, Lionel Bard, you mentioned Oompa-pa. So there's a certain amount of music hall sound to his work, and that's on purpose. Because again, that does sound, that does evoke the Victorian period. But for example, in they'll look for other ways to tell their story that allow you to have a contemporary sound. In Rupert Holmes's Mystery of Edwin Drood, there's a just a powerhouse song called Moonfall. That the ingenue character sings because her music master, who's perhaps the villain, has written it for her to sing as a parlor song. So in the earliest adaptations of The Mystery of Edwin Drood, an existing parlor song would be sung at that moment in the dramatic action. And that is used, an existing parlor song is used in the earlier film and later TV adaptations, where they'll select, so in the 1871 adaptation, melodrama adaptation of The Mystery of Edwin Drood, a song called When Stars Were in the Quiet Skies, which is it's a contemporary song. So its purpose was, because it was a well-known contemporary song that many people would have sung in their home pianos, in their parlors, it served to connect the audience directly to that ingenue character, because she is singing a song they've sung, that they know. No moonlit walk would be, or no moonlit ride would be complete without it, said one 1890s anthologist of old-fashioned songs. And the same thing happens in the 1930s film adaptation. The same thing happens in the most recent BBC adaptation. It's an existing Victorian parlor song. Obviously, Rupert Holmes is not going to do that. He writes of course a brand new art song that is the kind of art song that any contemporary soprano soloist at a jury for their master's degree would be happy to sing, and it's appropriate for her because she's a music student, right? She's a voice student working, performing what her composer voice teacher has written for her. So it feels powerful, but it serves a slightly different function for the audience. It doesn't. It proves that she's a powerhouse singer singing her great song, but forced to sing the words that this creepy music master is literally putting in her mouth because he's written the song for her. So it works slightly differently, but it works really effectively to get the same kind of sense across that the novel gets across.
So something I want to talk about is feminism. And we touched on it a little bit with Jane Eyre and a little bit just now with Rosebud's song. But we just celebrated the 100th anniversary of the 19th Amendment. And obviously, these are British texts that we're talking about today, but still, women's roles in society were quite different at that time versus yes. now. Yes. And something that I've noticed, and I think one of the reasons I'm personally drawn to all of these musicals, is that the women truly are powerhouses in these shows.
Yes.
And I think that the point of view, it really presents a more modern day point of view of the woman.
Yes.
I'm just hoping you can elaborate on that a little bit.
Yes. It right. Well, so in order to create stories that have things, you know, people, characters have to have something to overcome in any story, right? That's the way stories work. So in some ways, a Victorian text, the kinds of things that you have to overcome are so clear. It gives us some distance. So there may be parallels to the things that we also have to overcome, but it simplifies and perhaps clarifies by this creating this mediation, this estrangement, by looking at the situation through a Victorian lens. And the fact that it's British is also adds to that those layers of mediation, those layers of separation. But it can help us see things clearer because we're further back and further away from them. So I think that might be one way to think about it. But in some cases, it's surprisingly less feminist than you'd think. So for example, if you look at The King and I, Anna Leon Owens's own books portray in many ways much less conventional figure than the musical does. And the kinds of, although it's a musical that champions and celebrates a powerful female figure who can stand up to the king and can have a huge impact through her teaching on the future king, who historically the crown prince Tula Longhorn really did free the slaves. So Anna Leon Owens really did teach him, and she really did give a copy of Uncle Tom's Cabin to one of the wives, who were all, by the way, all the wives were slave owners. So there are things about the memoirs that Anna Leon Owens wrote that are far more they're far more slippery in terms of understanding race and gender roles and power than the 1951 musical, which because of the simplification in part, and this is in no way to, I'm not in any way saying that the musical is worse, it's fantastic, brilliant work of art, in ways that Anna Leon Owens' writing is maybe, it's not as good a memoir as the musical is a musical, but it's different. It's really interesting how she portrays herself and portrays the world she's in and the fact that the world that she describes in the harem, the Nang Han, the city of women, it's a city of 9,000 women, and all the judges, all the storekeepers, all the, everyone in that city is a woman fulfilling every possible role. And in 1951, how many female judges, how many female store owners, how many, can you imagine a city of 9,000 women in 1951? I mean, in the United States, the roles that the musical depicts are roles that we are, that 1951 is very familiar with. 1951 America was very familiar with. So it doesn't really break ground in terms of feminism, because women, weren't enslaved, and they legally had the right to vote, although there was voter suppression for women of color, but they certainly legally had the right to vote in terms of the Constitution. They certainly had the right to be school teachers. There are plenty of 1951 women school teachers. So it doesn't really break ground there. It doesn't, but it does really interesting things in The Small House of Uncle Thomas in terms of race. In terms of that musical it deflects what the memoirs were so interested in doing with gender and women's rights onto what Rodgers and Hammerstein were much more interested in, which was civil rights and the real serious work they did, like insisting that their musicals only be shown in theaters that had desegregated seating. They would not allow their musicals to be performed in a segregated theater. So South Pacific was not welcome in certain theaters, and same thing with King and I. So I mean, Hammerstein was the vice president of the NAACP. So I mean, they were much more interested in civil rights and racial justice, I think, than they were in the feminism that is inherent in the source text of that.
So you mentioned in the book that Victorian basically means Dickensian, and you mentioned the impact that the Victorian time had on even things like Wicked and Hamilton and this enduring legacy. And I would love to hear you go into that a little bit. What is the enduring legacy of the Victorian time period on our culture and on Broadway?
Wow, okay. So it is true that for Broadway, Victorian is Dickensian. So you get Dickensian elements. So two of the musicals I talk about, two chapters are focused on musicals that are adapted directly from Dickens. But all of them have Dickensian elements, even when they're not adapted from Dickens. And they sometimes show up in really surprising ways. So the best example is probably with Sweeney Todd, which is, you know, probably might be my all-time favorite musical, actually. But with Sweeney Todd, when I asked Sondheim, what does he think of when he thinks of Victorian literature, Victorian culture, he said, "I think Dickens. I see Dickens, the Dickens novels, the couple Dickens novels I've read and the Dickens movies I've seen." So he just laid it right out there. It's, and you see it everywhere. You see it in Sweeney Todd. Of course, there's the very important role of Beadle Bamford. If you look at the original source to the Sweeney Todd story, go all the way back to 1846, 1847. There is a beadle, but he is a very insignificant character. He isn't even named. He just shows up at one point as a minor, functionary to investigate a smell that's coming up from the church cellars. Because in the novel, the church is adjacent to Mrs. Lovett's and Sweeney Todd's establishments. So that's all. He doesn't show up again. He's not important. But by the time you get to George King's movie from the 1930s, suddenly there's a big old beetle in the Sweeney Todd story, because Toby, the apprentice in Sweeney Todd, is brought to Sweeney Todd by a beetle who's trying to take him from the workhouse. So it's a scene that's just straight out and just plucked from Oliver Twist and plunked into this movie version of Sweeney Todd to introduce Toby into the story in this way that people are already familiar with, right? So, and he's not an important character in that movie either, but there he is with this Sweeney, this whole hog Oliver Twist interpolation. So then what happens by the time you get, so one intervening thing is the popularity of Oliver Twist and all of the adaptations of Oliver Twist blending into Sweeney Todd adaptations. But then move forward in time from the 1930s to the 1960s, the adaptation of of Oliver Twist suddenly has a big singing beetle, an important beetle who has great songs and is a villain. So, you know, fast forward to Sweeney Todd and a character who didn't exist in the original as anything other than an unnamed functionary suddenly is a major important singing beetle villain. So that's one way in which the Dickensian elements. Now, why Dickensian? Well, Dickens becomes shorthand for social justice issues again, the plight of the poor, especially children's privation. So anytime you want to indicate the multiplicity of people that are suffering in an urban environment, Dickens becomes the go-to iconography. And you see that also with Jekyll and Hyde, by the way. No characters that don't exist at all in the novella, The Strange Case of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde, seem to be imported directly from Dickens into early stage adaptations and then early film adaptations, all the way up to Frank Lloyd Garrison's musical.
So we are just about out of time. I have a couple last questions. If there's anything that you wanted to say and didn't have a chance to, or anything you didn't get to put in the novel that you want to speak about, please feel free. My question, I always end with a couple of parlor games. And so the first is called Lighting the Candle. And I'm wondering if there is a person, a resource, an organization, something that you would like to illuminate.
Oh, well, so I actually just like to credit someone. It's not so much lighting a candle in terms of an organization, but I would just like to point out that the book, that this great, here, I don't know how to make myself visible and the book. Okay, this book cartoon where you see Dickens, Bronte, Stevenson, and Rossetti in a kick line was this cartoon was drawn by Ethan Gilberti. And Ethan, I commissioned this cartoon from him. Ethan has just graduated from LSU. He was an undergraduate when he drew that cartoon, and it is on a book cover. He was the lead political cartoonist for the campus newspaper, and he also happened to be he was my undergraduate research assistant, and I just lucked out incredibly by having not only a very smart, wonderful research assistant, but somebody that was talented and could do this. And so I told him, I said, I want a kick line, in fishnet and hose, when he drew it the first time, Charlotte Bronte was the same size as all the others. And I said, oh, you know, she was really short. She was tiny. She was as short as I am. I'm only 4'8". And so then he came back with a second one, and sure, he touched the ground. So I just thought that was great. So hats off to Ethan Gilberti, who is so talented.
That's awesome. So my last question is called The Parrot. And if we were all your parrots, what would you teach us to say?
Yes. So I'm going to get political here. We have an election coming up. Don't throw away your shot. We don't have much time. And this is one of the few times in your life when your vote really means something. So vote. Don't throw away your shot. So I'm not going to throw away my shot. I'm going to vote. And also musical theater provides quotations for all circumstances.
I love that. Sharon Aronofsky Weltman, thank you so much for being here, for your exuberant energy, your enthusiasm, your scholarly work that is my new favorite, for sharing all of your stories and your heart. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for having me.
All right. Thanks, everybody, for watching. I hope you all have a beautiful day. Bye.